Okay, if you could all take your seats, we're ready to begin. I'd like to welcome all of you to the De Nicola Family Colloquy. The title of this year's colloquy is Vatican II's Declaration on Religious Liberty, Revision, Reform, or Continuity. Let me begin by thanking the De Nicola family, Tony, Christy, and the whole family for making this event possible. We're pleased to bring to you two outstanding world-class scholars who have been engaged in a debate over the proper interpretation of the Second Vatican Council's Declaration on Religious Liberty, which Pope Paul and the Council Fathers promulgated on December 7th, 1965. This is a debate that's been going on since approximately 2011, and we're proud to host what I would hope to be a progress in the debate, or at least a clarification of the central issues. I will let each of them explain to you their interpretation, and then we will have some exchange. So we'll begin with opening remarks from each of our panelists, about 20 minutes apiece. Then they will have an opportunity to respond to each other, and then we will open it up for questions. On my right is Father Martin Rhonheimer. On my left is Professor Thomas Pink. Father Martin Rhonheimer is Professor of Ethics and Political Philosophy at the School of Philosophy of the Pontifical University of the Holy Cross in Rome. He studied history, philosophy, political science, and theology in Zurich and in Rome, and holds his doctorate in philosophy from the University of Zurich. In 1983, he was ordained a Catholic priest, incarnated in the prelature of the Holy Cross and Opus Dei. Father Rhonheimer is a member of the editorial boards of the American Journal of Jurisprudence and a member of the scientific board of Acta Philosophica. In 2002, he was appointed as a corresponding academician to the Pontifical Academy of St. Thomas Aquinas. He is the author most recently of The Perspectives of Morality, Philosophical Foundations of Thomistic Virtue Ethics, and also The Common Good and of Constitutional Democracy. In 2012, he published in German a book on Christianity and the Secular State. He has published on a wide range of topics, especially concerning the philosophy of moral action, virtue, natural law, bioethics, and the ethics of economics. Professor Thomas Pink is a professor of philosophy at King's College London. He read history and philosophy at Cambridge University, where he also received his PhD. After working for 4 years in London and New York City for a city merchant bank, he returned to philosophy in 1990 as a research fellow of Churchill College, Cambridge. He then lectured at Sheffield University prior to moving to King's College in 1996. Professor Pink's main interests are in ethics, philosophy of mind and action, philosophy of law, and medieval and early modern philosophy. He's the author of The Psychology of Freedom, Free Will, A Very Short Introduction, and joint editor of The Will and Human Action, From Antiquity to the Present Day. His recent scholarly articles deal with issues of free will, determinism, action and coercion, and religious freedom. So please join me in welcoming our panelists. And we will begin with opening remarks from Father Rhonheimer.
Thank you, Ryan, for this introduction. Let me express my heartfelt thanks to the organizers of the 2015 Fall Conference of the Notre Dame Center for Ethics and Culture for this invitation to debate here in this wonderful place about the important issue of the Church's teaching on religious freedom. As most of you probably know, the origin of this debate was a series of articles in different languages in which I defended Pope Benedict XVI's interpretation of the Second Vatican Council, namely its decree Dignitatis Humanae on religious freedom. My reading of this decree and my defense of Pope Benedict's interpretation of it was challenged and criticized by Professor Thomas Pink, with whom this evening I have the honor, but considering his great dialectical capacities, also the burden to debate on this topic. In the following introductory remarks, I'll first summarize my own position, the main points of Professor Pink's criticism, and my reply to it. In his Christmas message given before the Roman Curia on December 22, 2005, Pope Benedict XVI cautioned against a widespread interpretation of the Second Vatican Council, which would posit that the Church after the Council is different from the pre-conciliar Church. Benedict called this erroneous interpretation of the Council a hermeneutic of discontinuity and rupture. The warning was enthusiastically taken up by many Catholics concerned about modernist misinterpretations of the Second Vatican Council, with the opinion spreading that in his speech, Benedict had opposed the hermeneutic of discontinuity with the hermeneutic of continuity. Many have understood it this way, as the idea seems consistent with efforts at harmonizing pre- and post-conciliar church teaching on religious freedom, efforts which defend the existence of an uninterrupted continuity between pre- and post-conciliar doctrine. In my view, however, this understanding is misguided. In the Pope's address, there is no such opposition between a hermeneutic of discontinuity and a pure and simple hermeneutic of continuity. Benedict XVI has never asserted that the pre- and post-conciliar church doctrines on religious freedom are the same or that they are in perfect harmony. In fact, the idea of reading Dignitatis Humanae in the light of a hermeneutic of continuity did not come from Pope Benedict, but from Monsignor Lefebvre, the traditionalist founder of the Society of St. Pius X. During his negotiations with the Holy See, before stepping into schism, Monsignor Lefebvre proposed a reading of Dignitatis Humanae able to eliminate any discontinuity between the doctrine of this conciliar decree and the traditional teaching of the popes. His hermeneutical proposal was to reduce the meaning of these texts to the traditional pre-conciliar teaching, and with this to suppress any doctrinal novelty of Dignitatis Humanae altogether. Precisely this was the idea of hermeneutic of continuity. However, this attempt at undoing the renewal of Vatican II turned out to be a complete failure. It was rejected in 1985 by the Congregation for the Doctrine of Faith, at the time presided by Cardinal Ratzinger, the later Pope Benedict XVI. Although the Congregation held the view that concerning the dogmatic teaching of the Church, there was no contradiction between tradition and the Council, it simultaneously rejected as invalid Lefebvre's arguments in favor of a total continuity and harmony with the earlier Church position. In 1987, Lefebvre responded to this rejection with his book, Ils l'ont découronné, They Have Uncrowned Him, that is, Christ. In this book, the decisive point at issue and the cause of the conflict became obvious. The Council, Lefebvre argued, had abandoned the ideal of the Catholic state. According to the ideal of the Catholic state, the Church has the right to enforce her claim of truth and in consequence, church law and discipline regarding the baptized by means of the coercive power of the state. In a traditionally Catholic nation, the tradition holds, the state and its officials, as far as they are baptized, are bound to recognize this right of the Church in its legal order and practice, and also to support the Church's suppression of heresy and the spreading of false religious beliefs. In short, Monsignor Lefebvre defended the right of the Church to coerce in religious matters and to inflict penalties by the use of the temporal power of the state. As his 1987 book makes obvious, this was his main accusation and the reason for his rupture with Rome. Obviously, Lefebvre's conception is incompatible with the civil right to religious freedom, liberty of conscience, and freedom of public worship. These rights, now recognized also by official church teaching, are not reserved to those who profess the true, that is, the Catholic religion. They are the rights and liberties of all persons, Catholics or not. Moreover, they are based on the recognition of the secular character of the state, its political and legal autonomy, and its sovereignty with respect to religious authorities. According to Monsignor Lefebvre, between the traditional position and the teaching of the Council, there is no reconciliation possible. The project of reading the conciliar texts according to hermeneutics of continuity had failed. It is precisely against this background that the importance of Benedict's 2015 address to the Roman Curia, with its shift in terminology towards a hermeneutics of reform, reveals all its importance. Benedict did not maintain a strict opposition between continuity and discontinuity or rupture, but introduced the category of reform, which is the real key to understanding the Second Vatican Council, including its teaching on religious freedom. So Benedict explained, quote, "In contrast with the hermeneutic of discontinuity is a hermeneutic of reform," end of quote. Now, Benedict asks, in what does this nature of true reform lie? The nature of reform, he answers, lies, quote, "in the interplay on different levels between continuity and discontinuity." The nature of reform lies in the interplay on different levels between continuity and discontinuity. Continuity, therefore, is not the only hermeneutical category for understanding the Second Vatican Council. The category of reform is also necessary. It is a category which includes elements of both continuity and discontinuity. But as Benedict emphasized, the continuity and discontinuity are situated on different levels. It is most important, therefore, to identify and distinguish these different levels. On the one hand, there is the level of the political conception of the role of the state, which may be conditioned by history. On the other, the level of dogmatic principles and principles of Catholic doctrine, mainly the teaching that the Catholic Church alone is in possession of the fullness of truth in religious matters and is thus necessary for salvation. The crucial question is how these two levels, church and state, religion and politics, are related to each other in theory and practice. On this, the Pope asserted that, quote, "the Council had to define anew the relation between church and modernity," end of quote. As Benedict continued, precisely in this context, quote, "the relation between the church and the modern state had to be newly defined, a state which gave space to citizens of different religions and ideologies, acting with neutrality toward those religions, and which assumed responsibility only for guaranteeing the orderly and tolerant cohabitation of citizens and the freedom to practice their own religion," end of quote. It is clear, Benedict continued, that regarding the Council's teaching, quote, "in all of these areas, which as a whole represent a single problem, there could seem to be a certain discontinuity and in a certain sense there was discontinuity, end of quote. At the same time, it can be said that, quote, in principle, that is on the level of dogmatic principles, nothing of continuity was given up, end of quote. Thus, again, quote, precisely in this interplay on different levels between continuity and discontinuity lies the nature of true reform. In the Preconciliar Church Magisterium, the doctrine on the unique truth of the Christian religion was linked to a doctrine on the function of the state and its duty to assure, to the benefit of the church, the prevalence of the true religion and to protect society from the spread of religious error and heresy. This implied the ideal of the Catholic state, in which the Catholic religion is the only state religion and in which the legal order must always work to protect the true religion. As I have argued, precisely here lies Vatican II's discontinuity with the doctrine of the 19th century popes. A discontinuity, however, that does not affect any doctrine of faith or Catholic teaching on morals. It rather brings into view a deeper and more essential continuity. As Benedict explained in his Christmas address, quote, with the decree on religious freedom, the Second Vatican Council both recognized and assumed or made its own a fundamental principle of the modern state, while at the same time reconnecting itself with the deeply rooted inheritance of the church. End of quote. This fundamental principle of the modern state that is simultaneously a deeply rooted inheritance reassumed by the church is, for Benedict, the rejection of a state religion. Quote, the martyrs of the early church died for their faith in the God revealed to them in Jesus Christ, and as such they also died for freedom of conscience and for the freedom to confess their faith. End of quote. Benedict concluded his exemplification of the hermeneutic of reform with the doctrine of religious freedom with a concise statement. Quote, the Second Vatican Council, with its new definition of the relation between the church's faith and the certain basic elements of modern thought, re-elaborated or corrected some decisions made in the past. End of quote. This correction, to say it again, does not imply discontinuity at the level of dogmatic Catholic doctrine on faith and morals, a sphere which is the proper competency of the authentic magisterium and in which it is possessed of infallibility. The Pope thus spoke here only of an apparent discontinuity, since in rejecting an outdated teaching on the state, the Church has, quote, has recovered and deepened its true nature and identity. The Church was and is both before and after the Council the same Church, one holy Catholic and apostolic, making its pilgrim way through time. This is no rupture. In short, the teaching of Vatican II on religious freedom does take on a new orientation in the Church's social doctrine, specifically a correction of its teaching on the mission and the function or the role of the state. The Council gave the same immutable principles, mainly the principle that the Catholic Church was divine in origin and therefore had to have the right and the liberty to fulfilling its pastoral and salvific task, a new application in a new historical setting. These original Christian principles, based on the evangelical principle of giving to Caesar what belongs to Caesar and to God what belongs to God, in fact, suggest separation between the political and religious spheres, or what I call Christian dualism. The idea of a Catholic state as the secular arm of the Church in serving her pastoral task in the order of salvation is in no way covered by principles contained in Revelation, Scripture, and apostolic tradition. We therefore find a clear break here and retrieval of the original apostolic tradition in the teaching of Vatican II, which once and for all abandoned a historical burden formed by political contingencies and a body of rationalization in Catholic theology and church law. Such theology and church law was a response to the perennial need of the church to defend and secure her freedom, the libertas ecclesiae. This is why the Council's doctrine on religious freedom is essentially a doctrine on the functions and limits of the state, as well as on a fundamental civil right, a right of persons, of citizens, involving a limitation on the sovereignty and competence of the state in religious matters. It is also a doctrine on the Church's freedom, based on the corporate right to religious freedom to exercise its salvific mission without hindrance, even in a secular state. A right, however, and this is new, that also belongs to every other religion. Finally, it is a doctrine on the state's responsibility to encourage, in a neutral and impartial way, the creation of the necessary conditions in the public and moral order within which religious freedom can flourish and citizens can fulfill their religious duties. Benedict XVI's reading of Vatican II in the key of hermeneutics of reform was a penetrating achievement set forth by a great theologian. It was immediately watered down by those who feared a weakening of church authority by discontinuities in her teaching. So they continued to talk about the hermeneutics of continuity, allegedly proposed by the Pope. Others tried to seek new ways to avoid admitting the obvious, that there was a great novelty in the Council's teaching, leaving behind an outdated tradition. One of those who share this attitude, so it seems to me, is Professor Pink, who not only challenged my interpretation of Benedict's Christmas speech to the Curia, but simultaneously proposed a new version of a pure and, I must say, surprising hermeneutic of continuity. Like many, Professor Pink is concerned about a possible change in church doctrine. In a 2012 article in First Things, he expresses his concern of possible abuse of my position. Quote, "If doctrinal change is possible on religious liberty, why not on matters like sexual morality and marriage?" End of quote. Moreover, in that and other articles, Professor Pink defends the jurisdiction and coercive authority of the church over the baptized and her right to inflict penalties, an authority, as he contends, denied by those who interpret Dignitatis Humanae as a change in doctrine, as I do. However, on the basis of a hermeneutic of reform, as proposed by Pope Benedict, such difficulties, in my view, disappear. Matters like sexual morality and marriage concern principles of dogma and of Catholic morals, not the other contingent level of politics and the relationship of the church to the world. And the jurisdiction and the coercive authority of the church over the baptized is in no way put into question. We will come back to this issue. Yet Professor Pink is not satisfied by such an answer. What he proposes in order to save the authority of the church is that the continuity is not based on what the council actually does teach, but on what it does not say and rather conceals for reasons of policy and prudential restraint, despite, as Pink contends, continuing to hold it. Her claim of having the right to impose her jurisdiction over the baptized by means of the temporal power of the state. What were his arguments? According to Pink, I falsely affirmed that earlier church teaching attributed to the state itself is a right under natural law to enforce the true religion, and that the novelty of Vatican II was to abolish this teaching about the nature and the task of a temporal power of the state. To this, Pink objects, quote, "The state's past licit involvement in religious coercion was never under its own authority, but was always under the authority of the church," end of quote. Therefore, so Pink concludes, I am wrong in saying that the council has, in contrast to tradition, adopted a secular and modern conception of the state and, as a consequence, given up any claim to enforce her discipline and law with the help of the temporal power of the state. I think Professor Pink has seriously misread my argument. In fact, I have never asserted that there existed an earlier church doctrine of attributing to the state a right under natural law to coerce in religious matters. I always asserted that in the past it was the church that imposed this task upon the temporal power as a duty. Pink's affirmation that the state's past licit involvement in religious coercion was never under its own authority, but was always under the authority of the church, is completely correct. I have never affirmed anything different. As I have tried to show in my reply published in Nova et Vetera, one important cause of Professor Pink's misreading was the fact that he disregarded basic historical facts. They are essential in order to understand the development of a tradition that the Council has decided to abandon. Let me briefly explain. According to the tradition maintained by Catholic theology until the Second Vatican Council, the Church had the right to demand from the temporal power that it be subordinated to its jurisdiction in order to impose church law by means of the temporal power of the state on the baptized. This idea that the state was the secular arm of her spiritual power goes back to an early medieval tradition called political Augustinism, which does not, however, correspond to St. Augustine's genuine thought. In the factual order of salvation, according to this tradition, the temporal power of emperors, kings, and princes, and in modern times of state officials, though being a reality under natural law in the order of creation limited to temporal tasks, is bound to serve the spiritual power to achieve its pastoral goals, the salvation of souls. In modern times, and as an ideal in a society formed by Catholics, this meant that the state had to be officially, that is, constitutionally Catholic in order to assure that church discipline would prevail also in the civil legal order and in society. As I have explained in detail, and cannot explain so here, the partial dissolution of the genuinely Christian dualism between civil and spiritual power and their historical intermingling was the result of specific contingent historical circumstances. First, as a consequence of the elevation of Christianity to the state religion of the Roman Empire and the conflict with Arianism, which once again claimed a divinization of the state. Then during the early Middle Ages, due to the integration of the church with imperial governmental structures, and finally, as a reaction against this integration in the medieval political canonical doctrine of the plenitudo potestatis of the popes, the fullness of powers of the popes, and of which grew the modern idea of the confessional Catholic monarchic state, the views still held by Pius IX, with, of course, its corresponding Protestant version as well. This is why in my article I have called the traditional doctrine a doctrine about the duties of the state toward the true religion and about the right of the church to assert its claims by the secular arm of the state as an instrument of both temporal penalties and civil consequences. That the state or the persons representing him and his officials, qua officials, was understood as having duties towards the true religion is not tantamount to asserting that according to this doctrine, the state does so by its own right, or that it has such a right under natural law, as Professor Pink erroneously understood it. It means, however, that in the economy of salvation carried out in this world by the Catholic Church, the temporal power of princes and later of the state, besides being part of the order of creation, is equally part of this economy of salvation, not by its own right, but by being the secular support of the spiritual power. This doctrine obviously does not establish a genuine right of the state to coerce in religious matters. It does, however, establish a duty to do so under the supreme juridical power and moral authority of the church. With this doctrine, the classical teaching of Pope Gelasius, according to which regarding earthly affairs, the church is only the supreme spiritual auctoritas, sacrata, auctoritas, but not a coercive potestas, he made this distinction between auctoritas and potestas, was abandoned. It was abandoned not in official church doctrine, but rather in the pastoral and political endeavors of the great missionary expansion in the early Middle Ages, and later by the integration of the church into the Christian Roman Empire founded by Charlemagne and his successors, the Ottonian and the Salic emperors. A first clear testimony of political Augustinism is a letter by Pope Gregory the Great to the Emperor Mauritius Augustus, in which Gregory wrote, quote, "Who governs has received his power over all men from above, so that the earthly city be in service of the heavenly." End of quotation. These are Augustinian terms, but now they become, the earthly city and the heavenly city become identified with church and with institutions on this earth. The same conception was equally set forth in theological writings like those of Isidore of Seville, who affirmed that the power of princes was needed so as to impose, quote, so as to impose by the fear of punishment what the clergy is unable to bring about by words alone, end of quote. This led to the fact that from the times of Charlemagne, the temporal power of emperors and kings was considered to be sacred, and both civil and church law were considered to be ecclesiastical law. Charlemagne assumed the title of Vicarius Christi, and the anointing of kings and emperors was considered a sacrament. In turn, natural law was absorbed by church law and ceased to exist as an independent standard of right and wrong. This led to an increasing mingling of spiritual and temporal power, in the course of which the ecclesiastical power, mainly of bishops, became part of the political structure of the church, evolved into the imperial church. It was Pope Gregory VII who opposed these views by his papal revolution, as it is called, giving rise to a process ultimately leading to modernity. Gregory desacralized the temporal power of emperors, kings, and princes by reducing them to simple laymen and established the spiritual authority of the Roman pontiffs as a supreme and sovereign power able to morally judge ratione peccati, and even depose the holders of earthly power. Gregory VII famously claimed for himself the plenitudo potestatis and the title of Vicarius Christi. He did so for purely pastoral reasons, but this was the origin of the idea of judicial control of political power, later secularized by the Anglo-Saxon tradition of the rule of law. The papal revolution set forth by Gregory VII and his successors gave origin to a secular understanding of political power and a new flourishing of both canon law and natural law, both the ground on which the modern legal tradition of the Occident was built. After the Reformation, however, and in order to establish peace after cruel religious wars, the disruptive character of the still prevailing idea that political power and the true religion had to go hand in hand led to the conception of the confessional state, cuius regio, eius religio, which was not a religious, but a political formula in order to establish peace and the modus vivendi between rival confessions. The fusion of throne and altar, which existed in both the Catholic and the Protestant version, persisted until the 19th century and was the intellectual framework for earlier papal teaching on religious freedom, the ideal of the Christian state, in which, according to the long tradition of political Augustinism, the temporal power continued to serve as the secular arm of the spiritual power of the church. Yet through the centuries, the ferment of the earlier papal revolution had been fighting its way during the 19th century, and in consequence of the American and the French Revolution, perhaps even more of the Industrial Revolution and the most profound social and political changes it brought about, the older order lost all of its political legitimacy. Sticking to older ideas, the popes resisted the so-called new liberties. Eventually, with the Second Vatican Council, a theological change became possible, and the old tradition of political Augustinism was definitively abandoned. Concretely, it was abandoned by the Council's recognition in its pastoral constitution, Gaudium et Spes, of the legitimate autonomy of the temporal order, that though referring to God, is not to be understood as being in service of the church as her secular arm. This was nothing less than the theological overcoming of clericalism, the use by the clergy of political temporal power to impose on society church law and church discipline. And this was a great doctrinal achievement. With this, I come to the second pillar of Professor Pink's argumentation, briefly. It is related to the first one. Referring to impressive textual evidence, Pink emphasizes a constant tradition in canon law upheld in present canon law as well, which emphasized the right of the church to use coercive means in order to impose her discipline on the baptized. Now, to make this his case, this argument does not work any better than the first one. It cannot work because it disregards the changing historical context of the application of this right to use coercion, and therefore also the change in the political consequences of that right. In his reply to my 2011 article, Professor Pink emphasized that coercion by temporal means, which the church continues to claim as her right, is the same kind of coercion that the church claimed in the past. The church, Professor Pink contends, never gave up this right to enforce by coercion and church penalties its discipline on the faithful. That is, in the case of censuring and suppressing heretical views, for example. For this, Pink quoted texts by Pope Benedict and present canon law. However, they do not prove his point that there is no change in church teaching about her right to coerce, because Pink confuses, in my view, he confuses several things which must be conceptually distinguished. First, he confuses the church's right of jurisdiction over the faithful in the inner sphere of the church with a right of the church to claim for this the support of the temporal power of the state. Secondly, he confuses temporal penalties inflicted by the church with church penalties inflicted by the temporal power of the state. These are two totally different things. Temporal penalties inflicted by the church and church penalties inflicted by the temporal power of the state on request of the church. Temporal penalties inflicted by the church and penalties inflicted by the temporal power of the state are two entirely different things. Canon law still maintains his right, the church's right, to use many forms of temporal punishment which do not involve or require the coercive power of the state. There exist not only the strictly spiritual penalties as suspension, censure, interdiction, or excommunication, but also the temporal penalties of, for example, withdrawing a church office or benefice, which quite recently happened to bishops and parish priests alike, or withdrawing a missio canonica for a teacher in a Catholic university, for example, Charles Curran or Hans Küng, or even prohibiting teaching altogether for a period, Leonardo Boff, or even reducing a cleric to the status of layman, just happened with a gay Polish official at the Congregation of Doctrine of Faith. These are typically temporal penalties which, however, remain in the ecclesiastical sphere, have nothing to do with state power and politics, and do not affect the punished person in his or her property as a citizen, has no civil consequences. The temporal power of the state is not involved, and there is no claim of the church anymore to have it involved. And what is more, according to Dignitatis Humanae, the state has no right to act as an agent of the church, because he would thereby violate a basic right of persons as citizens, the right to religious freedom. With this, I come to the conclusion of my introductory remarks. As I have mentioned in the beginning, during the last decades, there have been several attempts at harmonizing Dignitatis Humanae with the old teaching on this topic. The one forwarded by Thomas Pink, however, surprised me indeed, and this in two ways. First, by finding at its heart a fundamental conceptual confusion regarding the coercive authority of the church, and more significantly, by the fact that, in my view, it can't help but mean that the teaching of Dignitatis Humanae is not genuine teaching, but rather a clever move of church policy, no change in doctrine, no abandonment of earlier positions, but almost in its last consequence, some kind of tactical retreat by no longer openly promoting a view which, under given political, sociological, and cultural circumstances, cannot be enforced anymore, at least for the moment, but without in any respect altering the traditional views on the relationship between church and state on matters spiritual and temporal. Professor Pink has written that according to Dignitatis Humanae, religious coercion by the state is now morally wrong and the violation of people's rights, not because religious coercion by any authority is wrong, but because the church no longer authorizes it. End of quote. I wish to contradict this view. As I see it, what Dignitatis Humanae teaches is that using state power as the secular arm in order to impose church jurisdiction on civil society is a violation of a fundamental right of human persons as citizens. It contradicts the truth equally taught by the Council of the legitimate autonomy of the temporal order of creation, to which state power, confined to care for the temporal common good, belongs. With Dignitatis Humanae, therefore, the Church returns to her original charism of clearly distinguishing what belongs to Caesar and what belongs to God. In my view, Professor Pink's reading of Dignitatis Humanae is not only a new version of the hermeneutics of continuity, once proposed by Monsignor Lefebvre, in order to make it possible to stick to the old views about religious freedom, but also, certainly without intending it, a serious attack on the integrity of the authentic magisterium of the Church. The idea that the teaching of Dignitatis Humanae is only a shift in church policy, not in doctrine, besides being theologically unsatisfactory, lays on the church magisterium the burden of lack of sincerity, undermining in a serious and dangerous way its credibility. In reality, the teaching of Dignitatis Humanae is not simply a case of prudential policy, not even of a morally demanded prudential policy, but rather a clear shift in doctrine in a field where the depositum fidei and basics of Catholic morals are not concerned and about which, therefore, the Church can never speak in a definitive or even infallible way. The only explanation for me as to why a philosopher of Professor Pink's standing would adopt such a confused theory regarding this doctrinal development is his love for the Church and his concern to preserve the integrity of the magisterium and her jurisdictional authority. His position stems from a desire to defend the Church from attacks from those, I think at least, that's my interpretation, that his position stems from a desire to defend the Church from attacks from those who take the discontinuities existent in her teaching on religious freedom as a pretext for questioning a series of other church teachings, especially in the field of sexual morality and generally on natural law, and to deny the Church's right to defend the integrity of the faith and to impose discipline by coercive means. I think, however, that Professor Pink has chosen the wrong way to defend the Church. The better defense is the one that tries to understand and accept doctrinal development where it really exists and to analyze its true nature. The result of such a defense, for which Benedict XVI has given us the clue, is to understand that the teaching on religious freedom, as set forth by the Second Vatican Council, is an example of true reform in the Church's theological comprehension of her relationship to the world. Thank you.
And now we will hear from Professor Fink.
I'd like to thank the Center for Ethics and Culture and the De Nicola family for inviting both Martin Rhonheimer and me to this session. It's a great honor. And I'd also like to thank Martin Rhonheimer for stimulating me to put so much effort from my side into this very important topic. I think it's very important to emphasize from the start, since Martin and I have been fairly robust in the way we've tackled each other in print, that there's a very important agreement between us, which is that there seems to be a very, very serious problem of discontinuity between the teaching of the 19th century popes and Dignitatis Humanae. And an awful lot of people have taken some rather shortcuts, I think, to try and get round this appearance of discontinuity or understate it. And I want to begin my opening remarks by saying why I think the problem is so serious and how it might be overcome. The 19th century popes called for the state to coerce, to issue legal directives backed up by threats of punishment in support of religious truth and against religious error, and to enforce the laws of the church. But in 1965, in Dignitatis Humanae, Vatican II taught something that appears quite opposite, that we have a right not to be coerced in our religious activities by the state, except where the state needs to protect just public order. Why have we a right to religious liberty against the state? Because the good of religion, the Declaration makes clear, transcends the authority of the state. And I quote the Declaration. Furthermore, those private and public acts of religion by which people relate themselves to God from the sincerity of their hearts, of their nature transcend the earthly and temporal levels of reality. So the state, whose peculiar purpose it is to provide for the temporal common good, should certainly recognize and promote the religious life of its citizens. With equal certainty, it exceeds the limits of its authority if it takes upon itself to direct or prevent religious activity. Now, this is a very important passage. It teaches a radical right to religious liberty against the state. Contrast our right to liberty of movement. We also have a right to liberty of movement against the state. But no one would say that we have it because movement is a good that entirely transcends the state's authority to regulate. The state clearly has a role in the coercive regulation of movement and travel, which is why our right to liberty of motion is subject to limitations in traffic regulations and the like. But because the good of religion does altogether transcend the authority of the state, our right not to be coerced by the state, where the good of religion alone is at stake, admits of no exceptions. The state cannot restrict our liberty for specifically religious ends, to protect religious truth, or simply for people's religious good. But then the clash with the pre-conciliar magisterium looks total. The 19th century popes were very clearly demanding state legal protection of Catholicism, not just to preserve just public order of a civil kind, but for specifically religious ends, because Catholicism is true, and for the spiritual good of the church and of the state's citizens. But Dignitatis Humanae condemns such state coercion for specifically religious ends as wrong, nefas, without exception. In 1965, the Catholic magisterium seems to have rather dramatically contradicted itself. There appears then to be a direct conflict between 19th century papal teaching and Dignitatis Humanae. Martin Rhonheimer accepts the conflict as real. Dignitatis Humanae, in his view, does indeed contradict the teaching on church and state of the 19th century popes. He says that this should not worry us, though. The doctrine that the state should coerce in support of religious truth was not on a matter of the faith or morals, Rhonheimer maintains, but merely teaching regarding the political application of principles of natural law, concerning not the church herself, but the functioning of the state. Such teaching about the application of the natural law in the political sphere, since not about the faith or morals, is supposedly revisable. The magisterium can contradict itself in respect of this teaching without undermining its own authority. Well, my view is very different. The 19th century papal teaching on the duty of the state to coerce for religious ends, to protect the true religion through the laws, was not a mere application of principles of natural law. It was teaching that whether true or false was in fact being proposed by the magisterium on a matter of faith and revelation, and Dignitatis Humanae did not contradict this teaching on the faith. As we'll see, those who framed the declaration went to great efforts to avoid any such contradiction, and I think succeeded in so doing. The conflict between 19th century teaching and Dignitatis Humanae is apparent, but only so. But how can the conflict be only apparent? The 19th century popes teach that the state has a duty to coerce in support of the true religion. Dignitatis Humanae teaches that it is wrong for the state to coerce this way because it entirely lacks the authority to do so. How could both teachings be true? There is only one way, I think. The contradiction can disappear only if the 19th century popes envisaged the state as acting on an authority other than its own. There must be another authority, the church, that can coerce religiously, and the 19th century popes must have been calling on the state to coerce religiously, not in its own authority, but as an agent of and in the service of the church. While by contrast, in 1965, Dignitatis Humanae must be addressing the state in a new context, as acting no longer as an agent of the church, but on its own native authority, and an authority that does not extend to the direction of religion. To see that this is indeed how to understand Dignitatis Humanae, and thereby remove the appearance of magisterial contradiction, we need to turn to the political teaching of Leo XIII, which, as we'll see, is central to the framing of Dignitatis Humanae itself. It is easy for us to assume, like Weber, that the state is the coercive authority par excellence, the only true potestas, the only sovereign authority entitled to enact laws and enforce those laws with threat of coercive force. But this is not historical Catholic teaching. In Immortale Dei of 1885, Leo XIII teaches that there are two coercive potestates, church and state, each with its own sovereign authority to legislate and punish, each governing its own distinctive coercive order, the order of religion and the civil order. And I quote, "The Almighty, therefore, has given the charge of the human race to two powers, potestates, the ecclesiastical and the civil, the one being set over divine and the other over human things. The church alone, according to Pope Leo, has the authority to coerce in defense of religion. The state, which has the authority to coerce in the civil order, has no coercive authority whatsoever of its own in matters of religion." And I quote again, "Whatever, therefore, in things human is in any way of a sacred character, whatever belongs either of its own nature or by reason of the end to which it's referred, to the salvation of souls or to the worship of God, falls wholly within the power of the church and is wholly subject to her judgment. Whatever is to be ranged under the civil and political order is rightly subject to the civil authority. Jesus Christ has himself given command that what is Caesar's is to be rendered to Caesar, and that what belongs to God is to be rendered to God." So the view that religion is a good transcending the authority of the state is not a novelty of Vatican II. It was already the teaching of Leo XIII in 1885, and it was not new even then. Leo XIII, in turn, took his teaching from the Jesuit political theology of the Counter-Reformation. In his defense of the Catholic faith of 1613 against James I of England, Suarez was already denying the state any coercive authority over religion in terms as total as Dignitatis Humanae. So there are two coercive potestates, church and state. Since both have authority from God, it must be possible for there to be harmony between them. Two forms of authority that are divinely sanctioned must be able to work together for the good of all. What does the cooperative harmony require? For Catholics, I think, church-state harmony surely requires at least this: respect by the state for religion as it's understood by all of Suarez, Leo XIII, and Dignitatis Humanae, as a higher good, religion as a higher good than any good of the civil order, and as a good transcending the state's own authority. It's the common ground. In Leo XIII's teaching, this respect and harmony will only be guaranteed if church and state are united and if, where religion is at issue, the state subordinates itself to the church. What form must the required union take? Here, Leo XIII appealed to a venerable model of church-state union, a model that goes back to the patristic age. This is the model of soul-body union, as he put it. There must accordingly exist between these two powers of church and state a certain orderly connection which may be compared to the union of the soul and body in man. The analogy is obviously rough, but clear enough. The body is sovereign, so to speak, in matters specific to corporeal flourishing, such as regulating the heart rate and the like. But in the higher matters that are of concern to the intellectual soul, such as whether to go to the library to get that interesting book, the body acts at the direction of the soul and on the soul's authority. So likewise, where the religious good is at stake, the state must be prepared to follow the direction of the church and to act on her authority in support of religion and religious truth, just as the body acts in intellectual matters at the direction of the soul. The whole point of the analogy is to communicate a principal agent relation between church and state in specifically religious matters. Where the good of religions is at stake, the Christian state is to act within the religious order as an agent of the church. How more precisely does the state come to act as the church's agent in religious matters? Through baptism, the sacrament that bases the jurisdiction of the church as coercive potestas within the order of religion. The state's authority in the civil order is based on natural law, and the state is under a natural law duty, just as we are too as individuals, to recognize revealed truth, should God ever give such revelation. Once the political community acknowledges Catholicism as true, its members, rulers and citizens alike, then become subject through baptism to the jurisdiction and coercive authority of the church. Where a state publicly identifies itself as Christian and publicly aspires to be a political community of the baptized, then baptismal obligations take political form, committing rulers and citizens alike to make the coercive resources of the state available to the church, to serve the good of religion under the authority of the church. As Bellarmine put it in 1610, invoking the political form monarchy characteristic of his time, "In fact, since kings through baptism have subjected themselves to the spiritual authority of the pontiff, they are considered to have subjected also their kingdoms and their political authority to the same spiritual authority." That is why Canon 2198 of the Post-Leonine 1917 Code of Canon Law could require the state, referred to in that canon as the secular arm, to enforce the laws of the church. Canonical obligation is founded on baptism, the sacrament which places the faithful under the authority of the church. And it is through baptism, as bringing with it specifically political obligations, that the church can place canonical requirements on the state. So the role of the state as a specifically religious coercer is entirely based on the authority of the church over the faithful based on baptism. And baptism and its nature is a matter not of natural law or its application, but of revelation, and in particular of a positive law that is revealed, the divine positive law of the new covenant. Historic church teaching concerning this authority is clearly not a matter of applying principles of natural law, but is instead church teaching which, whether you believe it or not, addresses a matter of revelation and faith, the nature of a sacrament of supernatural grace, and the obligations under a supernaturally revealed law which that sacrament can impose. Leo XIII taught that a soul-body union was required for harmony between church and state. In such a union, the state functions in religious matters as an extension of the authority of the church as potestas in the order of religion. In this context, the Leonine model entitles and indeed requires the state, at the church's behest, to protect the good of religion through state law. But supposing the state is no longer a community of the baptized, even in public aspiration, supposing the state no longer publicly identifies itself as Christian and no longer forms a soul-body union with the church, then the Leonine model will still apply, but now to deny the state any authority to coerce religiously. For now, detached from the church, the state functions merely as potestas of the civil order, and as such, has no authority to coerce in matters of religion. Our natural right to liberty, based on our human dignity, gives us a right not to be subject to coercive direction. To direct is backed by punitive threats, save those issued by a competent authority. Once it's detached from the church, the state entirely lacks competent authority to coerce us in matters of religion. And so our human dignity gives us a right not to be coerced religiously by the state, exactly as Dignitatis Humanae says. Let's look at the declaration, its preparation at the council, a little more detail now. We can read Dignitatis Humanae in more than one way. It's often read nowadays in what I would describe as a thoroughly anti-Leonine way. On this reading, there is no potestas on earth for the order of religion, and the church is an authoritative teacher, but not a truly coercive lawgiver. Religion is a field of human life that simply does not admit of genuinely coercive pressure by any authority. We are left with an importantly anti-Leonine view of religion as a distinctive good, altogether transcending coercive authority as such. I think that's the way most modern Catholics read Dignitatis Humanae. Or, as we've just seen, we can read Dignitatis Humanae in Leonine terms. On this view, in denying the state a coercive role in religion, the declaration is basing its teaching not on an exclusion from religion of coercion as such, but on a distinction of two coercive orders, the religious and the civil. On this second Leonine reading, religion does not transcend coercive authority as such, but only authority as exercised in the civil order. And it is with coercion in the civil order only that Dignitatis Humanae is concerned. These are two radically different interpretations of the declaration. It is very important that the Leonine reading was officially presented to the Council Fathers in the official relationes that the Commission drawing up the declaration provided to the Council Fathers to tell them how they were to interpret the declaration, and on that basis vote for it or against. Through late 1964 and 1965, the relationes become increasingly insistent that the declaration and its teaching on religious liberty is to be read and understood in Leonine terms. By September 1965, the Leonine message is a trumpet blast. The written relatio of that month roundly proclaims, "For the schema, the draft, rests on the traditional doctrine between a double order of human life, that is, sacred and profane, civil and religious. In modern times, Leo XIII has wonderfully expounded and developed this doctrine, teaching more clearly than ever before that there are two societies, and so two legal orders, and two potestates, each divinely constituted, but in a different way. That is, by natural law and by the positive law of Christ. As the nature of religious liberty rests on this distinction of orders, so the distinction provides a means to preserving it against the confusions which history has frequently produced. So the nature of religious liberty in relation to the state rests not on a general exclusion of coercion from the field of religion, but on the Leonine distinction between two coercive orders, each with its own governing potestas. It's just that the state is now functioning only in its native character as a civil potestas, and so entirely outside the order of religion. According to Leonine doctrine, the true coercive player where religion is concerned is the church, not the state. So what is the coercive role of the church? What can the church really and legitimately do to direct and punish those subject to her jurisdiction through baptism, the faithful? How do baptismal obligations bind the faithful to the church, and can they do so politically? The declaration is careful not to say. It is repeatedly affirmed, and in the most explicit terms in official relationes, that the authority of the church over the faithful is a theological problem to do with faith and revelation, not reason, which the declaration will not address at all. This is said most emphatically and explicitly by the official relator, Bishop de Smet, in that crucial final stage of the debate in October 1965, just before the final vote, and in relation to a very important change in the declaration's subtitle. The subtitle, de Smet says, now reads, "On the right of the person and of communities to a social and civil liberty in religious matters." The liberty or immunity from coercion, he continues, which the declaration addresses, does not have to do with the relation of man to the truth or to God, nor does it have to do with the relations between the faithful and authorities within the church. It really has to do with relations between people and human and civil society, that is, relations of people with other individuals, with social groups, and with the civil power. For these reasons, the freedom is termed social and civil. As a Leonine reading required, we're talking about liberty and coercion in the civil order. What of 19th century papal teaching on the duties of the state towards the true religion? It's again clear from the final Relationes, and again in a way faithful to the declaration in Leonine form, this teaching on the state's duty to the true faith was not being denied, but was being preserved intact or integer. Key is that famous clause added at Pope Paul VI's insistence so late in the day, shortly before the final vote. Religious freedom, in turn, which men demand as necessary to fulfill their duty to worship God, has to do with immunity from coercion in civil society. Therefore, it leaves intact, integer, traditional Catholic doctrine on the moral duty of individuals and societies toward the true religion and toward the one Church of Christ. Now, Martin Rhonheimer insists in his 2011 article that the declaration was intended to contradict 19th century teaching on the state's capacity and duty to act as the church's coercive arm. As he says, the conception of the tasks and duties of the state toward the true religion, which had been taken as authoritative by Pius IX, was tacitly shelved by the act of the solemn magisterium of an ecumenical council. And in his 2014 reply to me, Martin further insists that the reference to preserving traditional teaching on the duties of individuals and societies to the true religion specifically excludes any preservation of the traditionally taught duties of the state. But on the 19th November 1965, again at that crucial stage just before the final vote, de Smet said exactly the opposite. Commenting on the passage preserving traditional teaching on duties to the true religion, de Smet emphasized that the teachings preserved integer or intact specifically included 19th century papal teaching on the duties of the state. Let's hear what he says. Some fathers maintain that the declaration does not sufficiently show how our doctrine is not opposed to ecclesiastical documents up to the Supreme Pontiff Leo XIII. As I already said in the last Relatio, this material must be fully explained in future and theological and historical studies. As regards the substance of the problem, these things must be said. While pontifical documents up to Leo XIII emphasized the moral duties of the public power to the true religion, the last supreme pontiffs, while retaining this doctrine, complete it by expounding another duty of the public power, namely the duty of respecting the demands of the dignity of the human person as a necessary element of the common good. The text presented to you today recalls more clearly the duties of the public power towards the true religion, from which it is clear that this part of the doctrine is not omitted. So as officially presented, the declaration provides no challenge whatsoever to traditional teaching on the church as a coercive potestas within the religious order. And we find an explicit retention of traditional teaching regarding the duties to the true religion of the state, duties that insofar as they extended to coercion for specifically religious ends involved a delegated exercise of the church's own authority. A Leonine understanding of religious liberty is built into the declaration, and one which does nothing doctrinally to condemn the church's use, at least in the past, when states could function as communities of the baptized, of the Christian state as her secular arm in matters of religion. What if the declaration had taken overtly anti-Leonine form and explicitly denied the traditional doctrine of a coercive religious order served by the church as potestas? Well, that would have led to trouble, wouldn't it? As Yves Congar noted in 1967, only 2 years later, some would have wished that the declaration had contained a paragraph on liberty in the church. But the question was excluded. Not only would it have added to motives for opposing the declaration, I'm sure it would, not only would it have involved engagement in a delicate question which does not admit of simplification, Not only would one have added to the pastoral difficulties that the text already brought with it, but one would have again confused distinct questions. One must not on any account merge questions to do with civil and social liberty and highly complex questions of conduct within the church. That would have been deeply imprudent and dangerous.
Well, I take the liberty of assuming that the conflict has not been resolved, so perhaps, Father, you might respond for a few points, but I want to make sure that people have time as well to engage each of you with questions, so perhaps we'll get right to the heart of the matter, if that's possible.
Yes, well, thank you, Tom. This, but you caused me hard work yesterday, but when I received yesterday your text, so but I noticed that you omitted or avoided most points of our earlier debate, of my earlier criticism. So I assume that you have given in these points, and at least not okay. So I was too optimistic.
I'm sorry, Nathan.
Okay, but I noticed that now you have put the emphasis in the Leonine doctrine. That was a point or an aspect which you had in your earlier writing on that topic was only very marginal at the end, if I remember well. But now you have put it in the center. So I would wish just to say, well, I noticed 6 points, but that's the first point I've already said. Now, the second point would be on Leo the 13th. So I think, unfortunately, I think you have not succeeded in convincing me, at least me, that Leo the 13th really supports your case. You emphasize his soul-body relation, the metaphor. Now, I have checked the text of Immortality Day, and the text gives me another impression. You have interpreted this soul-body relationship in terms of Bellarmine, of a doctrine of, so to say, 200 years earlier, ecclesiology, and in Leo the 13th, it is, in my view, it's quite different. He says, well, yeah, it may be compared to the union of the soul and body in the man, and then he goes on saying, the nature and scope of that connection can be determined only as we have laid down by having regard to the nature of each power and by taking account of the relative excellence and nobleness of their purpose. So for him, the body-soul relationship is simply a parallelism of the two powers which, as he says, are both supreme in their order. So there is not a principal-agent relation as you have exposed, but it's a parallelism. And it's a harmony, a cooperation of two independent and supreme powers in their order. And then he says, there are nevertheless occasions when another method of concord is available for the sake of peace and liberty. We mean when rulers of the state and the Roman pontiff come to an understanding touching some special matter. That's the case of concordance, about, for example, Catholic religious teaching in state schools or marriage and all these things. These are the two things. So I think you have much overinterpreted the body soul metaphor used in Leo the 13th. However, Leo the 13th, in my view, he is a step away from the tradition of political Augustinism, precisely this idea of subordination of the state to the temporal power to the spiritual power. but at a price. And the price is very interesting. The price, again, contradicts a basic presupposition of your position, in my view, because he says before coming to this body and soul metaphor, he talks about the state having the duty, the state having the duty to publicly profess the religion and to publicly profess the true religion, which is easy to know which one is the true religion, he says. So all who rule would hold in honor the holy name of God, and one of their chief duties must be to favor religion, to protect it, to shield it under the credit and sanction of the laws, and neither to organize nor enact any measure that may compromise its safety. First, he talks about religion in general, but then he says they have to seek the true religion, and it's easy to find it. So, but this is a genuine competence of the state, not under church law, but of the state itself. So this is the consequence of his separation of powers, that he has to re-give the state a genuine competence in the religious matters, which also, in a certain way, implies coercion. Mm? So this also contradicts...
Could we let him respond to that?
Okay.
Look, it's true that he's talking about a range of duties of the state, but those apply to the state in different ways. And they must do so, given that he's already excluded direct authority to coerce in religious matters from falling within the competence of the state as potestas of the civil order. So you have, just as you and I do, the state has, just as you and I do as private individuals, a duty under natural law to recognize revealed truth if it's ever given to us. But just because you have a duty under natural law to recognize religious truth doesn't imply any native authority to enforce it. Who has the authority to enforce the truth depends, of course, on the nature of the revelation. And it's Leo's case that the revelation gives the authority to coerce on behalf of the revealed truth to another coercive body, the church. And it's true that you could, of course, understand the metaphor or analogy of the soul-body union in various ways that might not imply a principal-agent relationship, but I think it's true that Leo is part of a revival of Jesuit political theology through his friendship with Kettler at the time, where the work done by that analogy is precisely to communicate a principal-agent relationship. And that is how Leo is interpreted by the official theology of the late 19th and early 20th century church. Read Louis Chopin's Valeur des Déclarations Doctrinales et Disciplinaires du Saint-Siège, classic text arising either side of the First World War, which all the fathers of the Second Vatican Council who are Francophone would have been brought up on. And there, the state's activity on behalf of religious truth, for the sake of specifically religious ends, is always regarded as an agent, acting as agent on behalf of the church, as an extension of the church's authority as religious potestas.
Sure. Well, my point was about immortality. I just want to stick to the text, and I think it does not say what you made it say. So now I come back to another point you have noticed. This is this famous affirmation of Dignitatis Humani, that the 19th century papal teaching on the duties of the state towards the true religion. Well, it's not exactly the formulation. The council says, Dignitatis Humani says, that the traditional teaching regarding the duties of individuals and societies regarding the true religion is kept intact. Now, you have omitted, I'm sorry to say, that my interpretation is based on another text of the Magisterium, that is of the Catechism of the Catholic Church, who in his point 2105, you can check it afterwards if you want, or you can go online and check it right now. It says this following. The duty of offering God genuine worship concerns man both individually and socially. This is, quote, the traditional Catholic teaching on the moral duty of individuals and societies toward the true religion and the one Church of Christ, reference to Dignitatis Humanae. By constantly evangelizing men, now comes the interpretation of the Catechism of that passage, by constantly evangelizing men, the Church works toward enabling them to infuse the Christian spirit into the mentality and mores, laws and structures of the communities in which they live. The social duty of Christians is to respect and awaken in each man the love of the true and the good. It requires them to make known the worship of the one true religion which subsists in the Catholic and Apostolic Church. Christians are called to be the light of the world. Thus, the Church shows forth the kingship of Christ over all creation and in particular over human societies. Now, this is a completely different spirit from the Leonine spirit. It's, so to say, a bottom-up approach and not a top-down approach. It's the Christians, the Christian apostolate, the evangelical or the missionary impetus of Christians permeating society, laws, institutions with Christian spirits. This is the way of fulfilling the traditional Catholic teaching on the moral duty of individuals and societies toward the true religion. And then there is a second point, which I think you have perhaps overlooked. This is Dignitatis Humanae number 13. It's a very important point because there are two things to distinguish. Religious liberty or freedom, as it is taught by Dignitatis Humanae, and the right, the freedom of the Church, the libertas ecclesiae, the right of the Church to the right against the state of the Church to fulfill its salvific mission. So in Dignitatis Humanae 13, it is said that among the things that concern the good of the Church and indeed the welfare of society here on earth, things therefore that are always and everywhere to be kept secure and defended against all injury, this certainly is preeminent, namely that the Church should enjoy that full measure of freedom which her care for the salvation of men requires. This is a sacred freedom because the only begotten Son endowed with it the Church which he purchased with his blood, with his blood. Indeed, it is so much the property of the Church that to act against it is to act against the will of God. Well, this could, in a first...
For the sake of time, could we
But and I come to the point, okay. It's very important. In a first look, this could appear as if this was the old doctrine that the state has to acknowledge the true religion, the Christianity as the true religion, but this is not the case because the text says that this independence, this freedom, is precisely what the authority of the Church claim in society. At the same time, the Christian faithful, in common with all other men, possess the civil right not to be hindered in leading their lives in accordance with their conscience. Therefore, a harmony exists between the freedom of the Church and the religious freedom, which is to be recognized as the right of all men and communities and sanctioned by constitutional law. So the Church demands her freedom under the title of the religious freedom which is conceded to all religions, not a privileged situation, not a recognition of her being the true religion, but simply she now claims the freedom to fulfill her mission under the title of general religious freedom. This is the great difference, and this is the further proof of what Dignitatis Humanae really meant to say.
Okay, so you respond, and then perhaps you could ask Father a question.
Yeah. I think one of the reasons why this declaration looks kind of evasive, you know, you've got this sort of Leonine program in the Relationes, but it sort of kinds of reads as something a little more liberal than that, is that the fathers, the progressive fathers of the Second Vatican Council, the people behind this declaration, in at least some cases, had a very complex attitude to the history of the church. Supposing you're a follower of Maritain, one of which followers was, of course, Paul VI, not an unimportant figure, you really do believe the church was not in error in the past, what they call the sacral age, when she used states, Christian states, as her sector arm. And you certainly don't want, therefore, to condemn doctrinally that past use. And indeed, you want to make it clear that you're preserving that the teaching that endorsed it for the circumstances in which that use of the state was appropriate, when states were, in aspiration, communities of the baptized. But you've also got a view, which may or may not be true, but was part of the increasingly successful official theology of the successful party, that the separation of church and state is a good thing and is progressive, and henceforth the church should no longer address states as her potential agents, but as, in their own right, as independent potestates of the civil order. So you'll get these affirmations of past teaching, which, as Paul VI ordered to be read by De Smet on November the 19th, this is by Paul VI's order, they make it very clear, we're preserving that past teaching about the obligations of the state to the church, but then we're going to talk about the future in ways that bracket and sideline those past duties, which aren't going to matter anymore. And of course, when you write a catechism, you're going to be writing a catechism for people now and in the future. We all know that catechisms aren't about issuing, you know, including every single doctrine that's de fide in the church. They include doctrines that pastorally matter for the people that are reading them, priests and lay people. If you really think that the union of church and state is merely now an historical phenomenon, though perfectly proper doctrinally when it actually occurred, this is exactly what you're going to do. Preserve the past doctrine, but write catechisms that don't mention it in specific detail.
Say something to that.
Very quickly, yeah. Because yeah. We're already
only,
over time,
only,
and I do.
Yeah,
I would
only
like...
very quickly. Well, I think that. Well, you refer
very
to
quickly.
You refer to the Relatus Mens intervention in the council. Well, there was a big problem to get this declaration to get it through. You know, mm-hmm. So. They tried to really convince the more conservatives to, they used every means. But you have not to forget that Paul VI also let come Cardinal Journet. He made him a cardinal so that he could participate in the council. And it was precisely Cardinal Journet, who was a close friend to the Holy Father, and who was known to have a very traditional view on his dogmatic view on the church, so he was a trustworthy messenger. He said precisely that at the council precisely he explained the meaning of the text, of the final text, and he referred to that. I just say one thing what he said. He said that the doctrinal principle according to which the temporal is by its very nature subordinated to the spiritual, is in no way abrogated, but it is simply applied in a new way. That is, that resistance against errors should be carried out with the arms of light and not with the arms of war. That means without temporal coercion. So yep. That's... Both Cardinal Journet's...
But Martin, this Journet's speech is, you're right, very important. And it's classic Maritain, because, of course, Journet was an ally of Maritain. And Maritain has a theory that there is this constant superiority of the spiritual over the temporal, which is properly and legitimately applied in different ways in different ages.
Yes.
In the sacral age, it was properly applied in a way that involved juridical privileging of Catholicism as the true religion, and the state acting as the church's agent. That was not doctrinally erroneous, and Journet very carefully doesn't accuse it of being doctrinally erroneous. What he's saying is that we've now moved to a more advanced period. We've got a new moral superiority of the spiritual over the temporal. It's classic Maritain.
Could we... One or two questions, please.
I couldn't wait. Good Lord, I'm going to get 6 pints of Guinness, and I'm going to lock the 2 of you up in the finest room we have in this place, and you can continue. No way I'm trying to get into this fight. But neither of you have mentioned, that doesn't mean this isn't behind the scenes, neither of you have mentioned works such as Blessed John Henry Newman's Essay on the Development of Doctrine. That was underneath everything going on in the council. That's one text. The second text is what he wrote in response to Gladstone when Gladstone got so upset over the definition of papal infallibility. That letter to the Duke of Norfolk, chapter by chapter by chapter, is an absolute work of genius by Newman, where he speaks of the authority. He speaks of the early history of the church. He speaks of the primacy of conscience, that famous quote that he has. Yes, I would toast the Pope, but conscience first. Then he explains the quanta cura of Pius IX and the difference with the syllabus of errors, and cleverly gets out of it when he says the Pope never signed the syllabus. So he pays not much attention to that syllabus, then proceeds to go after the big gun in terms of the infallibility. Okay. All right, that's one.
Can I make a proposal since we're over time? Okay. It seems like there are a lot of people who are still interested in carrying on this discussion. Could we perhaps thank our participants, and those who would like to begin enjoying the reception may do that, and anyone who wants to stay, right, if that's okay with you? So the idea is that if you want to stay and listen or ask questions, then we'll continue to debate. If you want to go to the reception, then could we kindly ask you to do that so that the environment is hospitable to discussion? Thank you. So
I'm going to stop in a second, but it's extremely important for us. Pope Benedict XVI is the one who chose to beatify Newman on this. Mm-hmm. And it's not by accident that he's given us that whole thrust.
So the about development of doctrine.
It's development of doctrine, and it's
and
also...
And how does that factor into each of your interpretations? Well, Professor Pink, why don't you begin?
As far as I know about Newman, his point is about development of dogma. And this is not a question of the development of dogma.
It is a question of development of doctrine. I mean, no. Vatican II itself is either irreplaceable or it's not.
So Professor Pink?
The language of development is spoken in the Relationes, which of course I've been concentrating on, because that was the basis on which the Council Fathers were voting. And the way they put the development, which may not be sufficient development for you, I think, but is this, that... there's an original period where the church has been concentrating on the duties of the state to religion, and now we've come to understand better the duties of the state to the citizen. And that includes a very important duty to respect people's rights in matters of religion in the civil order. That's absolutely central to the Leonine application of the Declaration and consistent with it. Of course, there will be people who think that the Declaration is better understood as a more radical development in an anti-Leonine direction, where we abandon all this talk about potestates. And actually, I'm not unsympathetic to discussing that point of view. It's a very important one. And I would just suggest this. Here's some common ground if you want to do that. We've got this constant view in the Catholic faith that religion is a very special kind of good, above that any in the civil order, and transcending the authority of the state. What's the best way of relating church and state to get the state to respect religion in those terms? And maybe we could think of a radical development in the direction of new structures that would get the state to respect religion in those terms. My own view is that you won't actually manage to find those structures, and my own rather controversial view is the 19th century popes were right about the conditions under which the state will respect the good. But that's the way to go.
My view is we have Saint John Paul II in tertiary millennial.
One of the things that struck me about this debate that's been going on for 50 years now is that it's been taking place in a kind of historical vacuum. One of the biggest players...
I'll summarize it.
One of the biggest players in the creation of Dignitatis Humani was John Courtney Murray. No one's talking about John Courtney Murray or his associations or the influence that he had over the machinations behind the council. Nobody's talking about Father Fenton and Father O'Connell. These debates are taking...
So if I could just summarize. So the question then would be, how do you situate your interpretation in terms of the historical context of the debates that led up to this document with, for example, Father Courtney Murray and Fenton and the disputes, and situating the document in relation to these debates? You would want to know, how do we do that?
Well, this was not never my principal concern, the history of the document and of the discussion. Of course, I think Maritain was very important in this discussion. John Courtney Murray, I think he has a certain importance in the beginning, but he did not succeed, and he was not very much heard. And you must know, John Courtney Murray, he is well known in the United States, but he does not play. He is practically unknown in Europe. Perhaps some specialists know him, but he's not a figure in Europe. So, and I think on the council, he didn't really have his views. Didn't have a very deep impact, because the view he proposed was not very familiar to most of the conciliar fathers. And so they rather listened to other people. And I think Maritain was certainly important also because he was a close friend of Paul VI. They were very close in...
Tom, do you have...
Very briefly, Courtney Murray is a tremendously interesting figure because, if I've got him right, he didn't actually believe in the church as a coercive potestas. He's very unlike Maritain in that manner. He actually naturally understands the problem of religious liberty in anti-Leonine terms. And indeed, after the council, 1967, he actually attacks Leo XIII for having an incoherent theory of political theology. And you can see what's going on. He doesn't believe that the church is coercive potestas, so there's no possibility of the state acting as the church's coercive agent. And so he says, when Leo XIII denies the state any authority to coerce in matters of religion, and then calls on the state to coerce in matters of religion, he's contradicting himself. And that's a natural reading from Courtney Murray's point of view. But I think I agree with Martin that you can see that by the Leonine framework that's actually establishing itself to get the thing through, and please, the Mauritanians and not just the conservatives, Courtney Murray had to be sidelined. He wasn't going to provide the product.
I'll be quick. Father, you mentioned Lefebvre's title, four words, they have uncrowned him, which have the crystalline clarity of four other words, error has no rights. And you posit that the church adopted this view that the state could be neutral in terms of religion, but that seems impossible in the sense of legislators must answer questions, what is justice, what is the duty of a human being, which are inevitably theological questions. So or inevitably invoke an anthropology which theology speaks to. So my question is, if this neutral state idea, how does that not contradict the earliest creed of Christianity, which is three words, Christ is Lord?
So the question would be, Is it possible for a state to be religiously neutral, and is that the foundation of your claim of what you called the dualisms? The rightful autonomy of the state, is that the same thing as
I was going to refer to
religious neutrality. Is that a proper understanding of your position?
Well, I think it is a constitutional principle of all modern Western Occidental constitutional states in the classical liberal tradition, even the Constitution of the United States, prohibits an established religion. I know that it was a process. It was only on the federal level at the beginning, and then it was. So I know this history. Yes, of course, it can be religiously neutral, but the religious neutrality means that the state does not privilege any religion because it is the true religion, or because it is just for religious reasons. But of course there can be cultural reasons. Religion is also a cultural fact that belongs to the tradition of a country. We had in Europe, we have these quarrels about crucifixes in schoolrooms, for example. So if you go to Bavaria or to Italy, this is the most normal thing. Everybody has grown up with crosses or crucifixes, and there are Catholicism is in the culture. So even churches all the way around, and this is no violation of the neutrality of the public sphere. Not even in France, because at least it's important for the tourism. But religion is also a cultural fact, a social fact, and. It's no contradiction with the religious neutrality of the state or the other religious the secularity of the state that it also provides possibilities for the practice of religion and perhaps some special facilities for the majority religion. But in an impartial way. But these are considerations of political justice, not theological reasons, because it is the true religion. The state abstains from judgments of truth.
Well, I was...
Tom, do you want to say something about this?
Just very briefly, I think it's a very central problem about Dignitatis Humanae that you raised. We've got this central teaching of the Declaration about the nature of religion, that it's a good that entirely transcends the authority of the state. It's not, so our rights to liberty of religion aren't like rights to liberty of motion. Why would a state that did not recognize Catholicism or a form of Christianity very like Catholicism as true ever maintain such or assent to such a conception of religion? There's a reason why we as Catholics see religion as transcending the authority of the state, namely that Christ has arrived with a revelation that takes religion to direct us to a supernatural level, above any level directed by the state. But secular people who don't believe in that supernatural revelation won't have that conception of religion. Indeed, none of my secular colleagues in political philosophy think that religion is a good that entirely transcends the authority of the state. They think it's just another area of human life which the state can direct for the common good. They probably won't even recognize a distinctive good anyway. It's just like sort of, personal commitment or whatever. But of course, this declaration was supposed to address everyone and convince them just on the basis of reason. And I don't think it's going to do that. Not on that point.
And then Felipe.
So both of you, I think, suggested that the right to religious freedom that's outlined and explained in Dignitatis Humanae is primarily about immunity from the state. But if, as I think Professor Pink has been suggesting, religion is such a great good and has this kind of inherent value for us, then isn't it also the case that there has to be a certain amount of freedom from the church's coercive authority, even for the baptized? So I'm just wondering what the limits would be to what the church can do.
So the question is, you seem to acknowledge that the church does have some coercive jurisdiction over the baptized. Yes. What is the nature of that? Your question, you're asking, doesn't the church have to have coercive authority over the baptized? You acknowledge that, do you not? That the church has coercive authority over the baptized, juridical authority.
Of course. No, there was always a, I think also in Professor Pink's exposition, there was a sentence which I would not, which what is surprising because it's not, he seems to say that those who hold my position deny the fact that the church has a coercive power over the baptized, or that the church, in any case, can make laws and can impose their laws also with penalties. This is absolutely not the case, and I said that explicitly in my presentation.
Could I ask this question? Because this seems to me an important thing. You both seem to acknowledge this jurisdictional coercive authority.
The question
that I have is, how are you understanding that? Because I don't think you're understanding it in the same manner.
No, it's a question whether this coercive power of the church involves the right to demand the state to be her secular arm to impose this church law and church discipline on the baptized through temporal means on society, for example, by fighting heresy and prohibiting the public worship of religions which are not the true one and could
be... I ask a question in that regard? Because my understanding is the way in which that coercive power works is by binding the conscience of the faithful to perform a duty as a moral duty, which if they fail to, there can be punishment, penalties, which would include, could include deprivation of their power.
Yeah, but it's church penalties. But perform the church, with church means, for example.
Tom, can I, you want to?
Yeah, I mean, this is a really fundamental question, which of course was bypassed by Vatican II. They simply were terrified of dealing with it, I think, because there wasn't a theological consensus about how to think of liberty in relation to the church. And I suppose what you're going to start doing is to say, well, look, how do we think about liberty in relation to goods, in relation to the state, in relation to goods that fall within the authority of the state, like motion through space? And you aren't going to tell a transcendence story there. You're going to establish your space of liberty in some other manner. And I suppose the thought would be that you would want to have a total theory which would take each coercive order and say how that order, by virtue of its peculiar nature, would relate to the goods that fell under its direction in a way that gave a legitimate liberty to people under its authority. We simply haven't done that in Catholicism for donkey's years. The last really interesting discussions of this whole topic were in the 19th century. They involved Ignaz von Derlinger and the liberal Catholic theologians who had a beef with Pius IX, not just about infallibility, but about the idea of the church as a coercive power. And they wanted to understand this really, really in minimal terms because of their conception of the peculiar nature of religion. As I think they thought of it as really excluding coercion in most serious senses. All the church could do in her canonical authority is apply membership rules. So when I punish you by sacking you from your ecclesiastical job or denying you communion, I'm not seeking to pressure you. I'm simply withdrawing your membership rights. I'm no more pressuring you than, the yacht club pressures me when it sacks me as a member because I haven't paid my fees. And this is, of course, deeply opposed by Pius IX and Leo XIII's pontificate. And I'm not really answering your question in detail. I'm just saying there is this deep dispute which somehow went into silence after the 19th century and the exit of the liberal German Catholics. And Vatican II did not dare resurrect it in any serious sense. And it's the heart of the problem of religious liberty.
Well, I think this is again confusing. I'm sorry, but this has nothing to do with Dignitatis Humanae, simply. It's the question of that the Church has a coercive power that it can punish and it can impose duties or laws and so on is perfectly clear and regulated by canon law. Just take the Code of Canon Law, you have the whole list of interdictions and excommunication and under which circumstances they apply, and it's everything absolutely clear. There is no question that it is not. It was simply not a topic of the council. It was, but the council previewed a reform of the canon law. But at the time of the council, canon law existed. The problem of the post-conciliar church was that, of course, there was a kind of neglect of canon law, and bishops were appointed that did not enforce anymore canon law and church penalties, which was one of the reasons of the pedophilia problem, because this was a typical... But it was a question... It was not the question of church... The right of church to curse was perfectly clear. There was no... But it was not applied. Canon law was not applied. Church penalties were not applied because there was a... It was Paul VI who, after the council, appointed a lot of bishops who were, in a way, soft in their applying their authority. Episcopal authority was not exercised in that, and that caused great damage, and is one of the main reasons also why all these pedophile priests could circulate around, and they were not removed, they were not really under control, no, so I think. I think there is a clear differentiation to be made between the question of church, the right of the church to impose her discipline on the baptized by coercive means, that there are church punishments. They are always, of course, also meant to be medical,
medicinal.
Medicinal, to help. They are not just to maintain the public order as secular penal law is, but it has always a pastoral aim. But this is absolutely clear. The only pointed issue is whether this implies the right of the church to use the temporal power of the state to impose these punishments and to extend its jurisdiction through the coercive power of the state on society. This is the question. And I think here Vatican II is absolutely clear, because it says that if the church does this, it would violate a fundamental right of the human person. And this is a position, saying this is in contradiction with what Pius IX and his predecessor, also Gregory XVI, have been teaching. So in a way, the Vatican Council exactly teaches as a right what the pontiffs of the 19th century have condemned. There is a real contradiction, and this contradiction is a question of has nothing to do with the dogma of the church, because Pius IX, he was convinced that religious freedom implied the denial of the dogmatic truth that the Catholic Church is the only true church. Hmm? That was his conviction, that it led to indifferentism, to religious relativism. Nowadays, we know that this is not the case. Religious freedom does not imply that every religion is the same. It has nothing to do with that. Hmm? So there is a clear progress in understanding. It's a progress in understanding the relationship between the church and the world, the church and society. This is the progress, and this has nothing to do with Catholic dogma, but this is just the overcoming of a long tradition of intermingling of the spiritual power of the church and the secular world and the world of society, of a clerical view, and a clericalistic also organization of society in which the church was everywhere and the clergy was everywhere present, and there was no real freedom of the citizen, no basic rights. You could not express freely your opinion or your creed. It was always the danger that you were censored by temporal powers guided precisely by spiritual power of the church. So
speaking of which, Felipe Fernandez Armesto, I belong here at Notre Dame. It's been a tremendous privilege to be present at this exemplary engagement of two rigorous minds. And it's a tribute to the way that you've both stimulated us that you've made me want to disagree with both of you. But in view of the lateness of the hour, I'll just confine myself to one sort of late night quibble. One of the points in which you coincided was that you both quoted only one utterance from the lips of our Lord, which perhaps predictably was, render unto Caesar the things which are Caesar's, and unto God the things which are God's. And you also coincided in interpreting this as validating the notion of respective spheres of authority, civil and ecclesiastical, although you disagree fundamentally about the relationship between them. Now, I want to put it to you that although this interpretation is supported by every commentarist I know of, it is in fact delusive and wrong because it is insensitive to something which, in my submission, is essential to an understanding of our Lord in his human persona, which is his rabbinical sense of humor. You know, let's face it, he was a rabbi, and what is a rabbi without a rabbinical sense of humor? And in order to understand this text, you've got to understand it in the context in which our Lord uttered it, in the presence of fellow Jews who would have been rolling around clutching their vitals with laughter, because of course to them, everything is God's. And when Christ said, render unto Caesar the things which are Caesar's, he was making an ironical joke. Therefore, I want to put it to you, Father and Professor, that Christ, although his position would have been somewhat closer to Professor Pink's than to Father Rhonheimer's, would have adopted a position which was more radical than either of them.
It sounds as though he would have been a sort of hierocratic theorist of the school of Aegidius Romanus, where the Pope is Lord of all the world as Christ's vice regent on earth. Perhaps he would have been right.
Well, could I propose then that we once again thank our participants, and we'll let them enjoy themselves now for a little bit. Thank you very much. Yes, thank you very much.